Elder Dalton, Elder Lydia, Elder Mike, and Elder Johan. And you guys.
Yo.
Go ahead.
Hello.
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 So, ustedes pusieron muchas preguntas que querían darle a ellos. Cosas espirituales, cosas no tan espirituales. So we're gonna answer these now, all right? So, Dalton, I want to start with this. Is it too late to repent?
Thank you. Someone answered it for me. It is never too late to repent. The only time it's too late to repent is after death, all right? So if you are in sin, contemplating sin, you have every opportunity to repent. The only time the Bible says is a situation is when God gives you over back to a reprobate mind, meaning turn you over to the thing that you want more than him.
All right. Elder John, my favorite. Vamos a hacer uno en español. El anciano John, ¿cuál es el orden ideal para comenzar una relación?
Yo sabía que me iban a preguntar eso.
¿Estás casado, mi hermano?
Realmente yo pienso que es muy importante que las personas que van a estar en una relación sean estables emocionalmente. Entonces yo diría que el orden comienza siempre con cada persona individualmente. Cada persona tiene que estar estable, tiene que poder asumir responsabilidad, tiene que ser una persona que tiene una relación con Dios, tiene que haber madurez en la vida de cada una de las personas. Entonces yo diría que el orden, si lo vamos a poner así, el orden comienza con el individuo, contigo. Tú tienes que ser una persona entera antes de que puedas unirte con otra persona. Eso de que dos mitades hacen uno, eso es mentira. Si tú eres una mitad, tienes que estar completo primero antes de que entrar en una relación. Amén. Entonces el orden empieza contigo. Tienes que tú estar estable, ser una persona que puede tener responsabilidad, tener madurez y tener una relación con Dios.
Amén. All right. Number 14, we're going to go with Elder Ligia. I want you to give them, we just talked about prayer. Give them three practical steps on getting closer to God that are not just prayer.
I would say tip number one would definitely read books.
Come on.
You can definitely
pass out the books, by the way. We have many amazing books.
Yes. Tip number two is if, for example, in our house, we have mentors. So surround yourself with the right people that will constantly lead you to Christ and would constantly inspire you to be able to go after God and get to know him at a deeper level. And number three, make sure that knowing who you are in Christ is super important.
Amen.
So your identity.
That's good.
Always having that concrete. So, yeah.
Come on, let's give it up.
Amen.
Elder Mike,
next.
One of my best friends right here. Are trials always gonna come from God or does the enemy attack? You can get a little bit into that.
I wouldn't say that God would bring an attack. I would say that he would bring a test. That's exactly what the Bible says. You know, that God doesn't tempt you.
Come on,
but it's actually the enemy. So I believe that I think all of us here in this room could definitely identify that we've all been attacked or we've all gone through tests. And I believe that every attack and every test that comes into our life is for one purpose, and it's for our process to get us to our calling. So whether it is coming from the enemy or not, a lot of times the truth be told is that these attacks come because of ourselves.
Come on.
Sometimes I think we give the devil a little bit too much credit. I think that sometimes we are allowing the enemy to come in because we're opening a door to him. We're not praying, there's a lack of intimacy, we're making the wrong decisions, we fall short to the glory of God. And so because of that, I think that it opens the door. So sometimes it's not even the enemy, it's ourselves.
Come on.
So the key is to recognize where the attack is coming from and praying against it.
Come on. And you know, can I add on to that? A lot of times we try to take so much control in our life that it's not even an attack, it's just your own pride and you gotta deal with it. But the more you surrender to God, that's where these so-called processes that sometimes we make up in our own minds, you know, the better everything with God, amen? Elder Joan, anciano Joan, quiero preguntarte algo. ¿Cómo puedo darle cuidado pastoral a nuestra juventud?
Yo pienso que, by the way, si quieren escuchar la mejor serie que yo he escuchado en el cuidado pastoral, acabamos de terminar una, pueden comprar en la librería. Realmente el apóstol trajo una revelación fresca de lo que es el cuidado pastoral y recientemente hemos estado entrenando a todos nuestros líderes en esto. Entonces yo pienso que es una pregunta muy válida y muy relevante. Lo más importante que yo diría en referencia al cuidado pastoral es recordarnos que la moneda del cuidado pastoral es tiempo y amor. Voy a decir eso otra vez. Es muy importante que nos recordemos que la moneda, o sea, the currency of pastoral care, es el tiempo y el amor. Es imposible darle cuidado pastoral a alguien si no tienes tiempo para escuchar. Si no tienes tiempo para salir de tu horario, de tu agenda y sentarte con una persona, no escuchando para saber cómo responder o pensando cómo vas a responder mientras la otra persona habla, eso no es escuchar. Escuchar es poner todo lo que tú tienes en tu mente a un lado y darle a esa persona tu atención y sin interrupción. O sea, darle a esa persona todo lo que tú eres en ese momento y realmente escuchar. Y bueno, cuando escuchas, hacer ese tiempo de calidad y amar a las personas. El amor de Dios es lo más poderoso que tenemos.
Así es.
Es el amor de Dios que nos sacó a nosotros del pecado. Es el amor de Dios que rompe cadenas, que nos sacó del pecado, que nos sacó de las calles. Es más, ninguno de nosotros estaría aquí hoy si no fuera por el amor de Dios.
Así es.
Entonces, lo más efectivo que tenemos en el cuidado pastoral es el amor de Dios. Hay muchas personas que no les importa cuánto tú sabes hasta que no saben que a ti te importa. There's a lot of people that don't care how much you know. It's not about how much knowledge you have. It's how much you care about that person. You may or may not have the knowledge to answer, but God will give you what to do at that moment if you make the time. A lo mejor no tienes un estudio bíblico, a lo mejor no conoces 15,000 escrituras que puedes decir, pero si tú haces el tiempo y en tu corazón tú quieres ayudar a esa persona, Dios te va a dar lo que tienes que darle a esa persona en ese momento. Entonces, para el cuidado pastoral, dos cosas: el tiempo y el amor.
Vamos a darle un aplauso al Señor por el Señor.
I'm just going to say this really quickly. They're down there preaching, you know?
It's going to be short answers.
There's going to be an offering in just a moment, okay? Like, they're down here giving.
I got 3 minutes left. I'm going to give you one last question.
Okay.
Something that I do want to share, algo que quiero compartir, es que lo que yo amo de estos cuatro ancianos es que ellos no están predicando algo que no practican. Yo veo el sacrificio en privado, yo veo el fruto de su disciplina y su sacrificio por Dios. Entonces, todo lo que ellos están diciendo, agárrenlo y llévenselo a su país. Amen. Elder Dalton, last question.
Yes, sir.
What is the best way to differentiate between spirituality and mental health, and what is the importance of them?
That's good.
That's good. Come
so
on,
what is the difference between spirituality and mental health? Let's be real. The conversation on mental health is something that's kind of new to the church. Can you agree on that? Now people are really getting to that topic, but you know God's been talking about that since the Bible.
Come on.
God's been talking about, like, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And the Bible says, above all things, I desire that you prosper and be in good health, even as your soul prosper. So even when it comes on the conversation of mental health, the body, we know that we're a body, a soul, and a spirit. And your soul comprises of your heart, your soul, your emotions, your will. So that's where all those things are locked in. So when it comes down to it, when spirituality and mental health, I believe spirituality is how what's God's truth about you. And more when it comes to mental health is what you know about yourself. So that's a place of identity, what you're listening to, how you feel, what God is saying. If you're listening to the enemy and believing his lies, or if you're listening to your flesh, and in those situations, but when God is speaking, there's truth. And then if that's the case, you have a relationship, you have intimacy, therefore you can conduct yourself accordingly. And you can know when God is speaking because it lines up with his word. And if your mind is telling you something else, then it's not of God. Don't listen to it.
Come on.
Thank you. I mean, thank you. I tried on that one.
All
Amen.
Right. So I want to encourage you. We're going to take a quick break. How many of you enjoyed this little Q&A? We're going to continue to do these even on the Remnant podcast, Remnant YouTube. So stay connected. Vamos a continuar a hacer estos Q&As en podcast y en YouTube. Síganos en las redes. Follow us on social media y sigue a ser bendecido.